Phil Nelson was a writer, and he wrote a book called Tex Watson, The Man, The Madness, and the Manipulation. And I read the book, and it was really incredible, literally, because it was so badly done, and his take on the case was so hostile, and the book itself was just poorly done, and it was something that you had to have. And there were some things in there, like trial transcripts, that had value, but generally it was not a very... I don't want to be too disparaging, but not a very well-done book. And so when I moved out to California and started living with Sandy, he approached us, and he would do things like send letters and saying he would enclose $10. He said, here's $10. Would you, I'm Bill Nelson, would you speak to me? You know, he said, the $10 is going to get our attention. I'd say, send that back to me, please, and say, well, thank you. You know. But that was his technique, and so we pretty much rebuffed him and said, you're not going to have anything to do with you because obviously your take on the case is pretty prejudiced, and you're not being too speaking too kindly of the other characters in the case, and we don't believe your sincerity. So I don't know whether he took that as a personal insult or not, but he would... after that, he put out a book called Manson Behind the Scenes, and that was in a similar vein, a little longer. And then he had a website called MansonMurders.com, where he was putting up posts every few days, and I used to have to monitor it every day, because he started getting quite hostile towards Sandy and myself, and very insulting, and saying that she was a crazy nut, and ranting and raving, and all this stereotypical stuff about Manson people. And so I would monitor it. Every day I'd bring it up and kind of look away. And when the thing would come up, it'd be like, oh, thank God, he's on Leslie's ass today. We can breathe. And then, but every once in a while, he would put up something just outrageously insulting and stupid. And so my policy was to ignore him and don't give him the time and the satisfaction of knowing that we're even aware that he exists. And so finally, we were going out to the ranch, and Barker Ranch, and he was going out to Barker Ranch, and he would leave us notes in the guest book saying, hi, Blue, I was here. Where were you? Do you dare to leave this entry in the logbook? And we were like, what? You know, what is this? Wow. Where's this guy coming from? And so I even took pictures of some of his entries, because I'm an inverted photographer. I've got pictures of everything. And so finally, he was going to take a group of people out to the ranch. He was taking tours out there. In the meantime, we'd been doing a lot of Access Manson stuff, which had a lot of people communicating with us, and we had a lot of backdoor communication with people you wouldn't imagine. People would, for example, once somebody sent us an entire movie script of a Manson movie to say, and they said, hi, I'm working as an assistant for this production company, and I think they're really going to trash Charlie, and I'm really upset about it, and I'm sending you the script, so what do you think about it? And personally, I said, I think I don't have time to read it, is what I think. But what they wanted was a reaction that they could use for publicity, Manson girls upset about upcoming movie, you know, because we've always been tagged, and, you know, the same thing with the Dead Ginny book. They sent a copy for saying, you think the book I wrote about your sister called Dead Ginny, what do you think? I think you're a total asshole, is what I think. You know, but no reaction is the best reaction to that kind of thing. So we had a fellow writing to us, his name was Canyon Water, and I'm not sure, I never really was sure who he was, but he seemed to know TJ and some of his reference points of TJ's children. And he seemed to be connected with him through TJ and Lori. And Nelson was going to take a tour out to Barker Ranch, which by then was in the national park, and you needed a permit to run a tour in the park. You couldn't just go out there. You had to apply for the National Park Service and get permits and actually pay them money, which was, you know, building money to pay money for anything.
More than $10, huh?
Well, yeah. That was, you know, $10 was and, so anyway, he started talking about doing this tour out there, and he was advertising on his website, let's do a tour out to Barker Ranch. Well, Canyon Water got a hold of this, and he contacted somebody at the Park Service and said, you know, Nelson's running an illegal tour, what do you think? And Park Service said, we think he's not going to be allowed to do it. So that went back and forth for a while. And then eventually Nelson said, well, we decided to cancel the tour. And he's writing all this on websites and things like tours. But he said, we decided to cancel the tour. Okay, fine. We solved that problem. And then I get an email from somebody saying, you know, I've wormed my way into Bill Nelson's group of friends, and I'm totally hating and I'm a spy. And I just wanted to let you know that the tour of the ranch is secretly planned for the weekend of.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I said, oh, how interesting. So I was talking to Canyon Water, and I mentioned casually, you know, Nelson's going ahead with that tour, so I don't have any interest to you. And he said, yes, it is. I said, well, it's according to this person, they're going out there on weekend X. And so he alerted Park Service, and they were going to ambush Nelson when he showed up with his tour and basically bust him for running a legal tour. And I was just gleefully waiting for this to happen. And I was even considering going out there to witness it. But then I thought, you know, these people with Nelson, they're probably crazy, and I might get killed. So maybe I would not do that. But I was waiting for it to happen. And the weekend came, and I was, you know, waiting for to see something on Nelson's website or somewhere, but it didn't happen. Well, unfortunately, the day that he planned to go up there, someone in the park committed suicide. So all the law enforcement people had to leave and go deal with that.
Oh.
And so they were not able to stake out the ranch. So Nelson went up to the ranch and had his tour, and then he posted on his website, well, Lou, April Fools, and the joke's on you, because we had our tour. What do you think of that? And so I was furious that he didn't get busted. And so I pondered it for about a day, and I said, you know what? The worst thing I can do to somebody is be sarcastic. I have a very good wit, and I hate to say it, but I'm clever. And I can write really biting self-righteous things. So I said, you know, we're not going to ignore him anymore. I'm going to put a little post on our website, Access Manson, under our Media Watch page, saying, here's a major media person who is a complete joke. And I believe it was about 11 pages, and it had photographs, and it covered things like White Rabbit and the big dig up at Barker Ranch for the bodies that weren't there, and all the other joke things that Nelson did, his service with the Secret Service, and the Bruce Davis Zodiac, or the farce that theory was. And so I published it, and it was very funny, ha ha ha, you know, Bill, I'm making fun of you, what do you think about it? And he said, I was shocked to read this stuff that George wrote, and my friends say that I might have a good case against him for libel. And I said, it's libel, Bill. And I'm smart enough not to write something that's libelous, because I know about that kind of stuff.
Uh-huh.
But it's not liable, Bill. It's libel. So everybody was writing, because back then there were other message boards when there were things, and people were saying how great this was, ha, ha, ha. Well, I get another email from one of these backdoor people saying, I loved your piece about Phil Nelson. Of course, you know he's a convicted child molester. And I said, yeah, sure he is. I said, they said, no, he is. We got the report from your detective. I said, why don't you fax it over here and I'll take a look at it. And so they sent me the thing. It was very short, and it had a little summary of the charges and everything else. And I wasn't going to run with that, but it had a case number. So I called up San Diego court where it was filed, and I said, Do you have a case number 12345? And they go, yeah, we do. I go, what's the title of that? And they go, State of California versus Nelson. Really? So I thought, well, that's worth a trip to San Diego to check that out. So I went down there with my briefcase full of quarters and dimes and went down to the courthouse. And sure enough, they brought the file out. And there it was, convicted child molester. And I still wasn't going to go for it until I got to a point where he had to sign the court paper. So I copied the whole file, and went home. I was ecstatic, and I sent it to the person. I sent it to John Mesa. I sent it to some other people so it could get out there right away. And I put a post up on our website about it. Major Manson critic is a convicted child molester. And it was really a bombshell when it hit, because it was one of those things where you thought, there really is a God. And I couldn't believe that somebody with a background like that would want to provoke someone into looking into him. If only he'd been civil, he's entitled to his point of view. I disagree with his point of view. I disagree very much with his tactics. I thought they were cheap, childish, but he's entitled to it. But So I published that thing, and really, that set off a firestorm on the internet. It got much more reaction than I thought it would, and actually, an even more violent reaction than I had personally toward it, because I just thought the guy was a moron anyway. It wasn't too surprising, but he came back and forth denying the charges and this, that, and the other. I mean, I have to hand it to him. He held on for quite a while after that. He was a real fighter, Bill Nelson. Mm-hmm. And he was very effective in what he was trying to do, which was sabotage the parole hearing chances of Wesley Van Houten. He allied himself with Doris Tate, mm-hmm. and took advantage of that situation and kind of wormed his way into the case as far as being an advocate for keeping all the Manson people locked up, mm-hmm. which is not the hardest task someone could decide to take on. But it was very gratifying that we were the ones to find out to do that. And if only he hadn't been so juvenile and petty in the way he addressed us, it wouldn't even have occurred to me to even acknowledge that he existed. Mm-hmm. But he went too far when he got away with his little tour and got away with that. And then there were so many people that hated him.
Yeah, there are. Yeah. To this day, there's still people.
And I didn't hear what happened to him after that. He went on, and for quite some time after that, he was denying it, and his lawyer was...
He claims the charges were dismissed. Well, but he got that kind of dismissal. There's a certain number where you can get your rights restored.
It restores your rights, but it doesn't mean you're not...
Exactly. Yeah. It doesn't mean that you don't have to put on a job application,
for instance,
that you were ever convicted of a
felony. And the lawyer who helped him with that was Deborah Frazier, who also represented Susan Atkins, so that was interesting.
Mm.
So
I did not realize that.
So I don't know, John. I guess John. I sent it to John Asnile. Said you should sell this, John. You can call it the Bill Nelson pedo file.
Yeah. I'm sure he did.
So
I got it from him.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. So no, he got a copy like within 24 hours. It was in the mail because I knew he'd spread it around. Nick did the same. It was quite a thing to be able to take on somebody like that, because he was such a cheap shot. And he was, you know, they said he was stalking us, and there was some truth to that, because I think his family had relatives who lived in Visalia, which is 20 miles from Canton. So when he would come up to see them, he would drive by our house and he'd talk to the neighbors. What are they doing? And he'd report all these sinister things, like, and the neighbors say they can see that they're watching TV at night. What does it say that the Manson family, who are against, you know, everything having to do with show business, are actually watching television? And I said, Bill, how do you know we're not watching Manson videos?
Yeah.
We're doctoring ourselves. You know, and why are you bothering the neighbors? They like us. You know, don't come out here and do that.
Yeah.
You know, and he brought Jason up on a tour. He drove by our house and said, there's our house. And I'll tell you, Jason, he upset me because he sent me an email. He tried the direct approach. And he said, hi, I'm Jason. I know where you live, and I'm coming over to smoke grass and play music with you. And I said, no, you're not. And if you know where I live, you know I'm a 5-minute walk from Hanford PD, and if you show up here, I don't think I won't call in about 2 seconds and get you dragged off my property.
Mm-hmm.
So Nelson was a provocative guy. He was a stalker, I'd say so, because you never knew. And he would give the number. He put our house on the internet. I had to take the address number off the house because I didn't want people figuring out what I wrote it on pencil on the mailbox, so they continued to deliver mail. But to this day, we have a removable house number.
Oh, you do?
Yeah, so I had it off, and Hanford Water came off, turning off 115 and turned off ours by mistake because there was no address that they could do. So why isn't our mother? But, you know, I heard later, you know, that he had died, and I wasn't, he wasn't.
You didn't send flowers?
I did not. Well, we didn't know until later, because really, you know, we kind of dropped off. I remember writing to the people who were hosting his website and saying, you know, this person is putting our house on the internet with a purely intent to have people come over here and and bother us, because we were getting people coming over. They say, well, we saw your house on the internet. We know where you live. Well, that's kind of like saying, you know where I live. That's kind of threatening when somebody says that. I mean, who are these people? Some of them are ex-cons, and it wasn't pleasant. So he crossed the line of any kind of responsible investigative journalist of having a shred of respect for people. He took things personally, and he made things so personal that it was just beyond the pale of proper behavior. And as I said, he's perfectly entitled to his opinion and to express them civilly, but not through insults and innuendo. He told Hanford PD, somebody went and scratched 666 and other various things on Hanford police cars. And so Bill went over there and said, you know, you ought to look at George and Sandy, because they're into all that devil-worshipping stuff. And it's like, Bill, I'm 45 years old. What are you talking about? I don't go scratch cop cars. You know, and if I had to, because I was doing some stuff with my mom who was sick at the time, I said, if I have to, I can prove I was in Cincinnati when that happened, but I'm not even going to, you know, even bother to look at the ticket. It's so ridiculous. But he would say, they saw car lights leaving and headed in the direction of Sandy and George's house and the rest of that hemisphere.
Right.
So, yeah.
Points beyond.
And you know, it's funny because he went in later, and I was kind of amazed because he put it on his website. He went in later and tried to stir it up again, and Hanford PD obviously treating him like a nut, like, what are you talking about? And he put it on his website, giving that impression that they were totally shining him on. I mean, if I'd gone in and they said you're a nut, I wouldn't say anything about it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but
mm-hmm.
he didn't even have the good sense to do that, because he was always trying to stir something up. And he was always trying to get Sandy locked up for the rest of her life just because he didn't like her. And, you know, I took that very personally. It was like, there were some people who thought Bill Nelson was a kind of funny, buffoon, and clownish character. But to me, there was nothing funny about what he was trying to do. Just get my friend locked up for life for nothing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, as you were talking about his personality, something crossed my mind. He reminds me, not to the same extreme, but he reminds me of the BTK killer, mm-hmm. who was, you know, it was bind, torture, kill.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
And he was a city inspector, mm-hmm. who would absolutely jump down people's throats for letting their lawn get a little
officer.
Bit too high. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
For mm-hmm. letting their lawn get a little too high. In the meantime, he's going out and doing what he was doing. So it's the same type of personality, it sounds like.
Yeah, I don't want to get into a psychological evaluation of him, but he had problems. And it was just, I don't know why. If it's something in his background that made him that way. I really don't like to speculate on people's mental state. I'm not qualified to do that. I mean, I can have my own personal conclusions, which I have about a lot of things that I never say, because they're just my own personal conclusions and they don't really mean anything. But an unfortunate character to be connected with the case, although effective in what he was trying to do. I mean, I have to give him credit. He torpedoed Leslie's chances of ever getting out. He was certainly a big help in that, showing up at the parole hearings. And
well, it was a very thoughtful answer. Thank you.
Yeah.
In the book, you said, along the same lines of, you know, the character assassination, you were saying you've been called all kinds of things, including an arsonist. Is that him?
Yeah, there's Bill again. He said we burned down the Myers Ranch to send a message to Cappy, rather than just calling her or going to her house. But that's what it was.
Yeah.
It was somebody else who said I was a murderer, but Nelson said I was the arsonist, because he said on his website they're sending a message to Cappy. You know, we're burning down your ranch, your grandmother's ranch. You know, please. And it's laughable, because all the cops out there knew us. In Death Valley, they liked us.
Mm-hmm.
They thought it was neat that we were around. A lot of things. Ed George said we went over and dumped stuff on his porch, and sent somebody over to beat him up or something. I don't even remember. I mean, he distorted me in his book quite a bit.
And the white supremacist thing, you hear that every now and again.
It's a thin line, you know. I've been collecting German World War II stuff for quite some time, so you kind of get a reputation. Once you get a reputation, you kind of play into it. It's sort of like Charlie, you know, if you want me to be a Nazi, okay, I'm a Nazi. But as far as the ideology of it, I don't really pay that much attention to it, because I'm not really, you know, people to me are a small part of what life is, and I'm not really... The human experience, as I call it, is not the whole ball of wax to me. It's just a small part of what my life is. I've got nature going in life. And the human experience to me, it's almost like a diversion that they're trying to get you to be part of something that I've never felt part of. So, but, you know... as I said, I don't know if you want to call it white supremacy or something, but I do believe that there are differences in races. And I'm not judging one way or another, because you can say, well, the white race is more evolved than others. Well, it's evolved to the extent that it's created all this stuff that's going to destroy the planet, and it's driving people crazy. Because all this stuff that they come up with, people can't keep up with it. The society is evolving quicker than the human creature can keep up with it. And that's why you're seeing people going crazy more and more, I think. First of all, there are more people, so they're going to have more aberrations. And more of those aberrations, you're just not going to be able to keep up with all the craziness that this thing is beeping on my hip, for God's sake. You know, what do you want?
You could almost say,
if
you could argue the size of the deal,
but I mean, what's superior? Some guy who's created planes or a fish man who's been in the bush for 10,000 years and not going to be able to do it for another 10,000 years in a perfect harmony with nature? What is superior? You know, that's the judgment. And just because you're smarter doesn't mean you're superior to a turtle that's existed for 300 million years.
Or a cockroach.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it's all a judgment of relativity. And to me.
And values.
And values.
Yes.
Right. And life on Earth, you know, because that's the priority is life on Earth. How do you keep that going? Anything else? Anybody?
Anybody?
Good.
I'm good.
Thank you, George. That was fantastic.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Again,
that was a great pleasure.
All right. Nice.
You got a wrap?
Yeah.